Previously also we have spoken about these principles. Mainly we have spoken about or discussed about CIA, but today our target will be discuss it in an extended form. We call it CIAAN, and threat and vulnerability and risk. This part, mainly this risk part, we will discuss later, as we will have short time today. Okay. So first of all, what is sensitive information and why, you know, what are the information we want to secure from others or some illegal users or attackers? So mainly, roughly for a general people, the information, sensitive information includes things like username, password, credit card detail, Aadhaar number, biometric information, financial data, email address, home address, any ID card number, identifier of your phone, like EMEI number. Okay, so that nobody can clone your phone device as well. Okay, and some other are there, like in our religion, race, you know, image, login IP, from which IP you are logging in, birthplace, height, email ID, notification, identification number, name, date of birth. So you see one thing, all these things, what we are calling sensitive information, and we need to protect them. Most of us are sharing all our this information in open platform and in social media. Then very easy to find all this information by doing a little bit research about anyone. Okay. So CI, we have already spoken about. C stands for confidentiality, I for integrity, and A for availability. So in short, I will go through this. Okay. So if we can share, if we can assure confidentiality, integrity, and availability, all three things together, then we will say that we have security. Okay. So what is confidentiality? We already know that is roughly, you know, equivalent to privacy. That means how we can protect our information or sensitive information from reaching the wrong people, while making sure that the right people can in fact get it. So we have to assure that whoever is, you know, illegal or not authenticated people, or who don't have permission to see this information, should not be able to, you know, find them, or should not be able to read them. But at the same time, the legitimate users must have permission to, you know, read this information and read this information. Next, integrity. We also already know what is integrity. It is when information is not with you, but it is your information. Like you are sending something, some mail, say, to me. So that time, what is the assurance that when this mail is in the transmission or in the transmission channel or the internet, it is not going to be modified by anybody? Or so you send me a mail, and I'm not going to check the mail immediately. Maybe today you have sent the mail, and tomorrow I will check the mail. So during this time, this mail will be stored on the mail server. So when it is in the storage, during that time also, nobody is going to change our content. That is what the integrity is. At the same time, there is some other extended part includes under integrity. Okay, and sometimes we discuss them separately. So I will discuss them for you people separately. This is the reason that we have written this extra double A and N. Then is availability. You already know what is availability. Availability is that when we are using cloud services or online services, or whenever we are using any devices in the cyberspace, it should be available for the legitimate services 24/7. like you know, your hard copies of documents are always available with you. You can't say, you know, I'm not, I don't know where it is or where these things are kept. These are, you know, vague thing. The same way, when it is we are speaking, the things are you know, happening in the cyberspace, then also there should be assurance of availability that the server where you have stored the email or your document or say some cloud, it should be available for all the time. Correct. So some attack or some illegal activity may hamper this availability. So this is what about availability. Now come to this CIA or CIAN. So why this AN? First A we have added, see this CIA, I think you remember, it is confidentiality, C, integrity, I, and availability, A. This thing we already know, CIA. Next two things, two A's coming. First A is called authentication or authenticity. This is one A. And another A that is called accountability. Okay. Now this, okay, so this diagram and this is having a detail. This is basically, this A is basically this N. Okay. So what are these things I'm telling you? First come to this authentication. This authentication, sometimes in broad sense, we say that it is comes under integrity. But from the very basic sense, or you know, in micro sense, we may not say that, but in broad sense, we say that an authentication is also part of integrity, because authentication is a process which assures you that whoever is the sender or receiver, you can authenticate it. That means that I received a mail from you. There should be mechanisms so that I can be sure that, okay, I have received the mail from the correct person. Understand? Otherwise, if this authentication mechanism is not there, then anybody can send a mail with, you know, by taking name of somebody else, right? So like, you know, if somebody sends an anonymous gift to you from, say, Amazon, so it is, it may be hard for you that who have sent the gift. If you don't know, if you are not going to communicate with Amazon and asking that who is the person paid for it, right? So like that. So that is what, if say Amazon denies, you know, we can't say that who have deposited it. Like, you know, some another case you can see that, you know, somebody have deposited some money in your bank account, and the name given some anonymous name, and physically he visited the bank and deposited the amount. So at this time, it is very hard for you to find out, you know, who is the original person deposited the money if he himself does not reveal his identity. Okay. So that is what, you know, question of authentication. But when it is online communication like mail, messaging, or whatever document we are sharing over the internet or cyberspace, authentication is important at every step, right? So you can understand this. And then authorization, that means that, you know, the resources can be accessed by only authorized people. That means, say, you have sent a mail to me that I am the authorized person who can log into my mail ID and check the mail. Now if my mail ID and password are being compromised, somebody has stolen it, so they are not authorized, but they will be able to log into my mail ID and see what mail you have sent. Understand? This is what difference, thin line between authentication and authorization. Okay. And non-repudiation or accountability, what is this? Say you have sent something, some mail to me, and after that you can deny that, no, I have not sent this mail by mistake, it has happened, or some attacker have been done it. No, as long as the an originating email ID belongs to you, you will be responsible for that. Okay, in the same way, when you purchase something online, you paid, you have chosen something on your e-commerce website and you have paid and you are expecting that they will deliver the item within few days. But after a few days, when you are inquiring, that e-commerce website is saying that, no, we have not received your payment. So that is what is happening. But you really have done the payment. So at that time, it is a question of non-repudiation. So what they are doing, they are denying the receiving of your payment. They have actually their payment, the money is deducted from your account, but they are denying it, right? So this denial should not be possible. So what we will do at that time, we will contact the bank and we will track the transaction in what account it that money ultimately gone. So immediately we will able to find out that what was the destination or who was the receiver for that money and why somebody at that e-commerce website is denying or doing repudiation of the transaction. Okay, so this is the thing. So neither end, the receiver end or sender end, can't deny the responsibility or accountability whatever transaction has been done by them. The transaction can be any kind of transaction. It can be some sending of messages. It can be downloading something. Everything is transaction on internet. Okay. So authenticity is basically verifying the users are who they say they are and that each input arriving at the system come from that trusted source, right? So what is authenticity? When somebody is logging in to the system by saying that I am Mr. this or this email ID belongs to me, there should be some way to authenticate the person. So what does they say? There is Gmail. Okay, and I enter my email ID. Okay, so that means I'm claiming that I am Mr. This person. So immediately Gmail will ask, okay, if you are this person, then you must know the password, enter password. Okay, now I enter password. Then if that my account is activated with two-factor authentication, okay, then the Gmail will think that, okay, you have entered the correct password, okay, but this password may have been stolen by somebody and he is entering his password. If you are the real person, you tap on your phone, you are having a pop-up message there, or you got a OTP, enter that also, okay? Now, if I am the real person, I must have my phone with me and I will be able to enter the OTP as well. Then Google will authenticate me and allow me to enter into my Gmail account. So this is what is, this part, authentication, okay? And next thing is that the system come from the trusted source, understand? So whatever input or whatever message is coming to our, to our account or to our system, we must be able to authenticate that they are coming from a trusted person, a trusted source. So how we can understand that the source is trusted? We are having very less amount of power when if you think about Gmail and all, or any mail box. We have a very limited power to check the authentication of the trust of the source. But yes, still we have something like check the email ID, that this email ID belongs to a trusted email provider or not, or it is belongs to some trusted organization or not. All these things can matter. Okay. Now, non-repudiation or accountability, being able to trace the responsible party process entity in case of security incident or action or any action happens. Okay. So relationship among integrity, data origin, authentication, and run reputation. So you can see here, integrity is at the core. Okay, so if I was telling you that in broad sense, if we say integrity is maintained, then some of the non-reputation problems are also solved or assured by integrity assurance. Even authentication also, some of the authentication things are also covered by integrity, like mainly message authentication, we call it MAC, message authentication code. So this message authentication can be done by integrity. Okay, so this is the relation among these three things. Okay, now security services as per X800, first one comes is authentication. Authentication is assurance that the communicating entity is the one it claims to be. That means whoever is claiming that I am Mr. This, this is my email ID. So authentication should is a process to assure that or check that one. Okay. Then peer entity authentication. What is this? Mutual confidence in the identities of parties involved in a connection. Like you are having two mobile phones, okay, and you are transferring data among them using some Wi-Fi based data transfer app. So these two apps need to identify each other, okay, and that this is the sender mobile and this is the receiver mobile. Then only that is what called peer entity authentication. Then data origin authentication is another way of authentication that is assures about the source of the received data. Okay, then access control, the prevention of unauthorized use of a resource. That means the resources here, resource can be your system resources like printer, storage, processor, RAM, everything. Okay, so who can use them? Data and the databases, everything. So who can access them? Okay, unauthorized users should not get access to them. Only who have access permission, they will do this. So that is done by access control mechanism. Okay, who can have access to resource? That need to be decided by the organization. Under what condition access can occur? Okay, so in what condition, which data can be accessed, that can be documented and controlled? What those accessing the resource are allowed to be? Then data confidentiality, protection of data from unauthorized disclosure against eavesdropping. Traffic flow confidentiality is one step ahead of it. Okay, then data integrity comes, assurance that data received are exactly as sent by an authorized sender. Okay, no modification, insertion, deletion, or reply happened in between. Okay, then non-repudiation. So what is this? Protection against denial by one of the parties in a communication. Okay, origin non-repudiation, that means it can be divided in two parts, in two ways. Origin non-repudiation, that means the sender or the origin can't deny their accountability, and destination non-repudiation, that means the receiver or the destination party can't deny their accountability. Okay, then security mechanism. First comes cryptographic techniques. So it mainly have encryption and decryption method into it, and software and hardware for access limitation like firewall. Okay, there is software firewall and hardware version of the firewall. Okay, intrusion detection system and prevention system detect and prevent malicious packets. Then traffic padding against traffic analysis. Hardware for authentication like smart card, security tokens. Then security policies for access control are defined who has access to which resource. So this access control starts from the, you know, organization management team, that they decide that which kind of employee will get what kind of access to the cyber assets. Then physical security keep it in set place with limited and authorized physical access. Then cryptographic security mechanisms are encryption, also known as encipherment, use of a mathematical algorithm to transform data into a form that is not readily intelligible. Okay, so key are involved, so you need to know the key to decrypt it or read it. Okay, then called another thing is there, that is called massive digest. So similar to encryption, but it is one way you can decrypt it. Once you have the digest can be decrypted back to masses. Okay, so recovery is not possible. Generally, no key are used for this. So it is like, hash. Okay, then digital signature and message authentication. Data appended to or a cryptographic transformation of a data unit to provide the source and integrity of the data. So it is some additional amount of data added to, the messages or whatever you are transmitting over the internet, which will act or which will be used by the receiver to check the integrity of the data received. That means what is integrity, and to check the source of the data, that whether the source is the authenticated source or not. Then authentication exchange, this is third party, ensure the identity of an entity by exchanging some information. So some third party servers are there, they call it as authentication exchange. They help, the two parties, you and another party can be a server, and you and the server does not know each other. You are using a new machine or new device. So at that time, this authentication exchange will behave as a mediator between you and the server, and check both the side and establish a secure connection. Okay, then there is two kind of security mechanism. One kind is notarization, another kind is timestamping. You see, these two things, these two concept comes from our real life uses. So when say we promise something, see, the all my property will be given to you. Only this promise or word of mouth is not enough. What we do? We do make a will and notarize it from the court. So, but the same thing, when we promise something on the cyberspace, where is the court? Who will notarize it? So we need some mechanism which will help us to do the notarization. And another thing, timestamping. So in offline, whatever we do, we every time, under this, put our sign, date, and even place, right? So this is timestamping. Now in online also, this is very important to do. Okay, so notarization is use of trusted third party. So in real life, it is the court, notary office is act as a third party. So in online also, we have trusted third party to assure certain properties of data exchange. Then timestamping is inclusion of correct date and time within the message. Like you will find one thing, if you change your system date and time, you will not be able to access Gmail and many other websites, okay? Because their timestamp will not match with your system's timestamp, okay? In general model of network security, so what is the general concept of network security? It is look like that. The sender generates the message and secret information, also puts into it, and security related transformation like encryption or cryptographic techniques takes place there. Then it becomes a secure message. That secure message is sent over the internet. Okay, this is called the internet. This is public. Okay, anybody is having access to this. Okay, this is we called information channel or the internet. Okay, on the other end, we have the receiver. In the receiver part, what is happening? The secure message arrives, and receiver need to decrypt and do all the inverse process of the security mechanism applied here at the sender part. Okay, so this is the sender part. So receiver does all these things here, and finally gets the message what was sent by the sender, right? So here, say this sender and the receiver say communicating, and trying to establish a secure communication by authenticating each other. Okay, so who will help them? They need a intermediator. This act like an intermediator, a third party. So we call that them as trusted third party. Okay. So and another thing is there in this, when your data is transmitting over the internet, there can be opponent or attackers. Okay. So if this security is this secure message, what that means that it has some security. If the security is not good enough, it is breakable by this attacker, then your message is going to be leaked to the attacker. So here are the table. Here is a table which gives you relationship between security services and mechanism. So services are the service which can be provided using this mechanism. Okay, these are the mechanisms. These are the different techniques. Mechanisms are techniques. And if you use this technique, certain technique, what are the service can be assured by a technique? You can see encipherment or encryption is capable to give many of the services like peer entity authentication, data origin authentication, confidentiality, traffic flow confidentiality, and data integrity. We know everything, right? Each of them. Then digital signature, if you are using, it can help you both kind of authentication, data integrity, and non-repetition. If you want to if you are using access control, then it can only assures the service of access control. If you are using data integrity mechanism, it can give you the services like data integrity, non-repetition, and availability. Okay, authentication extends the third party. They can help you in query entity authentication and availability. Okay, traffic padding, it can only help you in data integrity, and routing control, which helps you in confidentiality and traffic flow confidentiality, and notarization helps you in non-repudiation. So when we communicate, say my phone or tab is connected to the internet, when you are communicating, when you are using some online banking system or some email, almost all these mechanisms are working in the background. We as a user only look at the application layer where these menus are there and all. Okay, but in the background almost all these services are available. Okay, then only the communications are happening. Okay, now model for information security. First one is design a suitable algorithm for the security transformation. Number two, generate the secret information used by the algorithm. Then number three is develop method to distribute and share the secret information. And four is specify a protocol enabling the principal to use the transformation and secret information for a security service. Okay. Next, NIST is an organization which works for standardization and specification, standard specification of most of the security related and information technology related things. And worldwide they are followed, but even they are a US organization called National Institute of Standard and Technology. Okay, formerly, previously it was called as NBS. Okay, so it is a non-regulatory federal agency within the US Commerce Department of Technology and Administration. Okay, so NIST mission is developed to promote measurement standard and technology to enhance productivity, facilitate trade, and improve the quality of life. So you can understand they facilitate the trade how? By giving the standards. So if they, you know, they given a standard, set a standard that say this USB port will look like this, okay, this is, you know, and if all the companies are going to follow it, then what is going to happen? Then the same USB and a pen drive can be used for all the computers and you know, other devices. So this is why we need standard, and this is how this, you know, standard can help and facilitate that trade. Okay. Then cryptographic standards and application also one of their mission, and Federal Information Processing Standard define the security standards. Okay. Then fundamental trade-off of among security and ease of use are, you see, that security may require clumsy and inconvenient restrictions on user and processes. Like, you know, when you are immediately you need to transfer some money to your friend, and when you are trying to log into your online banking system, first it asks for a password, then it asks you to solve a puzzle like captcha. After that, again it is asking for OTP. Okay, and so after you logged in, again when you are trying to transmit the account, it is asking for another OTP. So it is clumsy, it is inconvenient, but you know, for security we need to follow them. Okay, but now if you have option to inactivate all these things, and you want to only use your password, and for your convenience, if you do that, if you deactivate all the feature of OTP and captcha, then you are just losing the security. Okay, you and your account is going to be vulnerable. Okay, so if security is an add-on that people have to do sometimes special to get, then most of the time they will not get it. So security should not, if security is an add-on, if the thought process is like this, then most of the time the people, general people, are not going to follow it. Okay. So this is a code by what I was discussing, Martin Hellman, who is co-inventor of public key cryptography. Okay. And then everything should be as secure as necessary, not secure. So this is another thing, that don't put too many security features to make it very secure. Then what will happen? Okay, your system can be secure, but people will lose interest of using it. And like you will find that Facebook, once you log in to that app, it is logged in for lifetime on your device. You don't need to re-log in, right? So why? Because it is providing you convenience. But you think the other way around. You are sleeping and your friend opened your smartphone by taking your fingerprint. Then he have everything. He don't need to know the login password for Facebook. He can access your Facebook. You can understand how security is compromised, like to get a convenience. On the other hand, if you have a banking app on your phone, when you log out from the phone, it is also logged out. Now if somebody takes your phone when you are sleeping and use your fingerprint to unlock your phone, after doing unlocking, they will not be able to access your banking apps. Okay, so this is the difference what it means. Okay, now here the relation between threats, vulnerabilities and controls. Okay, now you see here, what is threat? Threat is basically the attacks. Okay, so threats are nothing but the attacker and illegal users who creates the attacks. Okay, who creates the attacks. Now, if we have deterrent control mechanism, that can reduce its likelihood of attack. Okay, some deterrent control, if we can put, like, if we have all the security in, devices in place and up to date and all, then it is okay. It can reduce the likelihood of attack happening. Okay. Then if you have detective control, then detective can discover that okay, some attack was happened, okay, and how it was happened. So that is detective. That is what you call detection. Okay, it is kind of detection. Okay, it can detect. Detection, okay. And then if it is a detection control, then you know when it is, attack is happening in the real time, it can also detect that okay, your system is undergoing into some attack, so it can trigger some preventive control. So how to the detection control found that some attacker is copying your database data from your database, okay. So he need few hours to control the whole database. So before, if you have a preventive control, then immediately you can apply the preventive control and you can stop the attack and you can protect some of your data. Okay. So if you have preventive control, it can reduce the impact or it can protect the vulnerability. Okay, and attack basically exploits your vulnerabilities in the system. Okay, so I should say this path is the basic path. Okay, threat creates attack, attack exploits vulnerability. Okay, so and vulnerability results in impact. Okay, and this is the thing, how this impact can be reduced and how can be detected and all. Okay, and once everything is happened, you can have some corrective control which can decrease the impact. Okay, so this is the relation, I think you understood. And security threat, so there is two kind of basic threat. One is human factor, another is natural factor. Natural factor means say lightning, hurricane and tornado, tsunami, all these things happened and your server and systems are being destroyed. So human being and security people in cyber security don't have much to do on it. But in the human factor, we have many things to do. There is two kind of human factor, internal factor and external factor. In internal factor, there can be former employees who previously who was working in your organization and current employee. So previous employees may have credentials and they know what is the configuration of your organization. So they can exploit that. And current employee, they have credentials to directly access the data, so they can exploit that or in different way. Then external threats are like malicious events, like attacks happens, like hackers or crackers are there who can send virus, trojan and worms to your system and servers in your network and exploit your vulnerabilities. Okay, so these are the threats. So thank you, I am stopped.